Good afternoon. I'm looking for...
Pull to open!
You've certainly come to the right place.
These short trips don't usually work. The chances of reversing a short trip are even more remote.
Oh, don't be so melodramatic.
How dare you!
Don't you remember?
Oh, the questions. Just remember.
I'll get my answer, Doctor, and I'll discover more about you and why this constant performance of yours.
All the world's a stage.
I might use that.
Hello and welcome to Pull to Open, an ongoing quest to watch all of Doctor Who in random order. And occasionally we don't go in random order. We take little side trips where we discuss Doctor Who as a whole and thorny little knotty questions of Doctor Who-ness that we ourselves have pondered over. And my name is Chris Taylor, and I'm excited to see what we come up with here. Pete, what have we got?
I'm
what have we got?
Paschal, and I am so excited about this. This is great. I love our side trips. I love our side quests. I like to slip sideways in time. I have good experiences when I slip sideways in time. So this is good times, and we're going to be talking about a big contentious issue. Which is not an issue. It's just a thing people debate a lot about Doctor Who, and it's a thing that inevitably comes up with almost any large franchise that has multiple people in lead roles, and in this case, the lead role, which is, who is the best actor to take on that lead role? And so that's what we're going to be taking on here. Who is the best actor to have ever played the Doctor, or, if you will, Doctor Who?
Indeed, some of these people will have played Doctor Who, some of these people will play the Doctor. Of course, we remember most of the classic series, the character was listed in the end credits as the Doctor. So you should technically say Doctor Who for most classic Doctors, I believe, at least until Davison.
You know what I just realized? We're doing the ultimate question.
The ultimate question of is it the Doctor or is it Doctor Who? Are we taking a side quest from our side quest?
I guess, because it's like we joke every normal podcast that the ultimate question is what we thought of the story. But in the show, the ultimate question is Doctor Who. We're kind of answering like, who is the definitive Doctor here? Not really. Best actor, definitive Doctor might be different things. So that's another debate. But right now, we're looking at performance, of acting ability, of the depth. And I guess I would ask you, Chris, right away, like, what is sort of the criteria there if we wanted to unpack what is a good actor or a great actor in terms of what they're bringing to a role? What are we looking for?
Well, this is an interesting thing that makes this a very unusual Pull to Open side quest, because normally we're dealing with the canon of Doctor Who, but for this story only, this side quest only, I feel that we can look at the other work of the actors in question. And I'm going to say that we should take this question as broadly as possible to include a wide and very interesting list of actors. I think it should be literally every actor who has ever played a character called the Doctor or Doctor Who, meaning a time traveler who travels around in a TARDIS. And so the first thing I'm going to say is that I feel we have to include Peter Cushing.
Yeah, that's fair. We're looking at the Doctor Who multiverse here, guys. Yes. So yes, we're definitely going to include Peter Cushing. On that note, I would say we should also include David Bradley.
Yep. We
should definitely include Jon Hurt.
We should definitely include Jon Hurt. And before we even get to Hurt, let's actually just go through these in chronological order.
Sure.
Chronological order of actors to play the Doctor. So the order is Hartnell, Cushing, Troughton, Pertwee, Tom Baker, Davison. And then I think we do have to include the actor who played William Hartnell's Doctor.
Absolutely.
In the five Doctors. What was his name?
Richard Hurndall.
Rich, that's right. I always thought it was.
Oh, I thought you were. I thought it was a trivia thing, and you were seeing if I knew. But you actually added it to the list.
I'd actually forgotten.
Everyone watching on YouTube is seeing you typing it on the spreadsheet now, or whatever you're filling out there. Yeah, Richard Hurndall.
Yeah, because I remember how strange it was they chose an actor whose name sounded like Hartnell, but was not Hartnell.
He was quite good. You know, I got to say, I don't mean not to get on. I know we're not even done the list yet, but like I remember I would say he probably did a better William Hartnell than even David Bradley. I think we could get into David Bradley because I think he's great. I just think if you're looking for an emulation of a style, Richard Hurndall in The Five Doctors does a really good job emulating William Hartnell.
Is it Hurndall or Hurndall? I always thought it was
Hurndall. H-U-R-N-D-A-L-L. So we're doing it live here, guys.
Wow. Yeah, you get an insight into the construction, the careful construction of a Pull to Open episode. Okay, so he's the next actor. Then Colin Baker, then McCoy, then McGann, then Eccleston, because we're going in chronological order of playing it.
I guess we're skipping over Curse of Fatal Death, right? That is a little bit, maybe we're getting too many people, because then you'd have...
Yeah, okay.
Should we?
No.
That's a lot of actors.
Otherwise, Rowan Atkins, like Joanna Lumley, yep. Like we're going to have to...
Hugh Grant.
We might have to give it to Hugh Grant. No, I think...
That's a can of worms.
It is a can of worms, very farty worms. It's a bad idea to include First of Fatal Death. I think we can at least say in a dramatic role, right? So comedy and parody not included.
Done. Good deal.
Also, I guess we have to not include the stage show. Wasn't there a stage show doctor or several stage show doctors?
Yeah. There was the Ultimate Adventure.
Yes.
And I think, I forget when Seven Keys to Doomsday happened, but I guess David Banks did play the Doctor once or twice during the run, but I think he was mostly sort of the understudy. But I remember hearing about the Ultimate Adventure, and it was Colin Baker and Jon Pertwee again, so... Yeah.
And we also have to say that there are actors who played alternate doctors in Big Finish audios. I think we have to exclude those.
Right. Because then you're throwing in, love you, Nick Briggs, but I'm sure he himself would exempt him from this whole thing. But
okay, so it has to be visual media. Visual media and drama.
That's good because it also peels off Richard E. Grant.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And who does not love to peel off Richard E. Grant of an afternoon? McGann, Eccleston, Tennant.
Tennant, of course.
Should we list Tennant twice? No.
Guy is so greedy on all these Doctor Who lists. No, one time.
We should even list Tennant three times, Metacrisis, Doctor, and... 14th Doctor. All right. Smith, then Hurt, Capaldi, then Bradley.
Right. Then Bradley. Yeah.
Unless we count Bradley in An Adventure in Space and Time, which came to come first, but I guess it doesn't matter. We don't.
Doesn't really matter the order. I mean, Bradley counts. And then Whittaker. Yep. And then Joe Martin.
And then, because we do have examples of his acting in other media, Ncuti Gatwa.
Yep. That's fair.
All right. So we have 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
That's 500 actors. Welcome to the longest Pull to Open we've ever recorded.
11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19 different actors in our list.
That's a lot.
Wow.
Even if we spend 1 minute on each one, that's already 20 minutes. So tell you what, Chris, I'm going to suggest something.
Yep.
I'm going to say, how about each of us come at this with a top five? Because I think we're just going to, and then we'll sort of see where those overlap and we'll see if we can come to a consensus. And then maybe right before we come to that consensus, we have a couple honorable mentions maybe of stuff we didn't get to talk about. Does that sound good?
All right. So that sounds great. Should we take turns for who's in our five? Because I want to start right away and say that I think for me, probably the only possible winner on this list is Jon Hurt. I think
Jon Hurt is huge.
He's also the only one who was specifically chosen as the most famous actor in Britain, because that is how he was listed in Stephen Moffat's script for Name of the Doctor, where the War Doctor appears for the first time. It literally says the most famous actor in Britain turns around, and he is the Doctor. Like, smash cut to credits. So yeah, he just is. He's acting royalty. If you look at everything he's done over the years, it just there is no equal. Like, and his TV work as well, Caligula, is extraordinary. And I think he shows that range in playing the Doctor as well, even though it's only one story. Barring all the big finishes, like he does manage to be. Like you think when you watch the end of The Name of the Doctor, you think that John Hurt being in it, like he's going to play it like very portentously, but like the twinkle that he brings to the role in Day of the Doctor is extraordinary. And he has that range of just being exhausted and furious. And it just, he is just the best natural actor on this list.
Yeah.
So
I got to say, he's definitely on my list too. So I think to sort of clarify something you said earlier. So yes, there are actors on our list that will have a large body of work and a lot of renowned work, but I think it's not just that. I think they do have to bring that range, that, getting of the character and of the script they're in, because in John Hurt, he's in one story, right? They have to really bring that to the foray in the work that they've done. So I think it's, they have to do that too, because another, if someone is a great actor but otherwise gave a naff performance as the Doctor, just wouldn't be on the list. So
yeah, Peter Cushing kind of has to,
I'm not actually, Cushing isn't on my list, right? Like, and again, I do like those movies for other reasons, but not necessarily for the acting. So, but Hurt, you're dead on. Like, he's not only an amazing actor. I mean, we're not going to give his whole resume here, but what he brings to that role, and not just the role of the Doctor, but the role of the Doctor in this story, where he's at. Like the line that there's a few moments I'm just going to handle, zero in on two, really, where Clara says to him, Jenna Coleman, you know, your eyes are different. Like, it hasn't happened to you yet. And you really believe it. You know, it's not just lines on a page. Like, you kind of are then looking at his eyes and looking at how the others are playing, you know, Matt Smith and David Tennant in that role. And you do sort of feel a difference. And it's not just that moment. It's like everything he's sort of done up to that moment with, you know, being in prison with them, the repartee he has with those doctors. So there's that moment. And then I'll go zero in. It happens almost right after. It's almost everything that happens, honestly, in the barn between him and Billy Piper and when the other doctors come in. But in particular, the stuff with Billy Piper, I forget if it's in the barn or just before, because he talks to her right before he's transported back. Yes. And he says of the doctors who he's been bickering with for the past hour, they're the finest people I've ever met. You know, and it's such a turn, like a surprising line, but yet not surprising. Like, the feeling is that it's earned. And he's just, that begets the whole line of like, great men are forged in the fire. It's privilege of lesser men to light the flame. You're just like, oh, I'm getting choked up just thinking about it. You know, it's like, that's such a good scene. So well written and so well performed by John Hurt. I mean, if he's not at the top of the list, he's definitely in the top five.
Yeah, and when you consider the weight that his shoulders had to carry in that episode, like he had to make us forget that Eccleston could have been in the 50th.
You know,
he had to make us believe there was a whole missing regeneration of the Doctor. And I mean, Night of the Doctor did that in part. You know, you definitely got to give credit to McGann for that, at least, even if he doesn't make our list. But Hurt really sells it in Day of the Doctor. Like, at the end, when he transforms into, he's like wearing a bit thin and starts to transform into Eccleston, you're like, oh yeah, there was another guy, wasn't there? Which perhaps is a good segue into saying that, because I don't want to put Chris Eccleston down, I think he should go on the list. I think he's my number two pick.
Love Chris. Yeah, he's a really great choice. He's probably on my list. I mean, now I'm kind of like, oh, do I have six on my list? but it's almost like, I wouldn't say cliche, but it's almost like a given, I guess. Like, you know, Chris Eccleston really brought this weight to Doctor Who by being the Doctor when it came back, right? Mm-hmm. Like, it was like he was very well known. He was obviously been in a lot of popular movies by that point, but also like he was you know, cut his teeth on things like Shallow Grave and yes. sort of other big dramatic movies that really showed the range of this guy. And so he brought that to the role. Like, the absolutely, I can't think of anyone better in the role of the PTSD Doctor, as we call him sometimes on the yeah. podcast. He's very wounded, and it comes out in big ways and little ways throughout the season, but he never forgets the humor. There's such a great balance there. Like, it's very, very smart. Very smart performance.
Yeah, he has so many layers to him. And he sort of does it in every role he takes on. Like, it's interesting that quite often if an actor who has played the Doctor is in something else, and I'm watching him with friends who happen to be Doctor Who fans, we're all like, oh, hey, it's the Doctor, and he's obviously got a pocket watch in his pocket. You know, and he just has forgotten that he's the Doctor. Like, when you see Matt Smith in The Crown, you're just like, why is the Doctor pretending to be Prince Philip? And maybe he should go through his pocket watches and open one of them, and one of them will remind him. Like, you can't ignore that it's Matt Smith, right? But you just mentioned Shallow Grave, and I'm thinking back to that. I think if I watch Shallow Grave again today, I would not think Doctor with pocket watch, you know. I would not right. think human version of the Doctor, totally. Because he's so different as a character, and he does bring that to everything, and he definitely brings it to the role of the Doctor. It's so much range in series one of just the haunted look, the hopefulness that comes through, the just this once rose, everyone lives. The way that he deals with Captain Jack, and it just, you know, and then the sense of reluctance that he has, because you do get the sense that he, you know, barring his personal conflicts on the show, he would have liked to have continued. Like, we were good. We were really good at the end. Like, he had so much more to give, and that has to be by any measure a classic season. And you know, and I'll add, as a northerner, lots of planets out of the north, but Gallifrey did not have one until Eccleston came along. He represented for the northern accent, and the too far north accent in terms of McCoy. And McGann, like, you know, was from the north, was from Liverpool, but always sounded a bit more posh. And Eccleston's like, no, screw it, I'm just going to let it all hang out.
Well, the star that burns twice as bright burns half as long, you know. It's the he was I mean, you know, it's almost poetic that he didn't get more seasons, that he had that one season, which is, I wouldn't say it's a perfect season, but it's almost kind of perfect for that Doctor and Eggleston himself. Even though I would really love him to do more with Doctor Who. I wish he had done more with Doctor Who, particularly with the 50th, even though we were just praising John Hurt. I do, and I'm glad he's back doing stuff for Big Finish and stuff. But that's one amazing season. I'm gonna sort of go back in time a bit here, because I feel like, you know, we've said two Doctors from the New Who era, but I want to zero in on classic, and I want to see if you agree that Tom Baker, he's not just a popular Doctor, but I do think as an actor, and, you know, we talk a little bit about a lot of behind the scenes stuff with Tom Baker, and it's not always favorable, but I do get a little bit of a sense of, like, that genius madness thing with him, you know. And I think a lot of that translates into the role. Does that mean he's a great actor? I don't know, but I do think the idea of the Doctor sort of being able to bounce from humorous warmth to deadly serious, looking at the classic series, I don't think anyone did it better than him.
Interesting. Wow, you've really zeroed in on my pain point here, which is that despite the fact that Tom Baker is my Doctor, he'll always be my favorite Doctor, I don't know that he makes this list. And I have to say that, unfortunately, Pull to Open has been part of the process of me thinking that he's actually not that great as an actor. Sorry, Tom. Sorry, Tom. Please don't listen to this podcast, Tom. this is the first time I've said that. I don't want to kill off the poor guy. It just all of the looking to camera. It's the looking to camera, like the fact that he's done it twice, that he broke the fourth wall. You know, oldest rule in acting, and he wasn't supposed to do it, and he brought a bit too much comedy to the role, like in the wrong way. But to your point, I'm going to say, you know, and maybe this sort of sealed the deal for me when you said you didn't know any actor who could go from that, you know, outrage to, you know, whimsy. I have to say Troughton. Troughton for me is the best actor of the classic era.
You're kind of convincing me, particularly with the fourth wall stuff, which is, it's tough because, I mean, if you think about, we go from John Hurt, who did like one episode with two other doctors, to Tom Baker, who did 7 years of the show. And it gives you a lot of material to, you know, make your case one way or the other. But I think to your point, there's so many places where you could make the other case against that. Maybe you kind of have to step back. And taking the entirety of that, it's maybe a little bit diminished. Yeah. But Troughton, you're dead on about that sort of whimsy, serious. He's definitely the doctor that it's so unfortunate that a lot of his stuff ended up getting junked. And his era is, for people looking back on it, there's just not as much to look back on. But the stuff that you, when we do go back to it, and we've only done it a couple of times here in the podcast, it's just really, really great. It's a delight to watch that guy.
It really is. And I have argued in the past that he sort of only has those two modes. He's either sort of shy and whimsical and kind of looking down at his feet as he's doing this, or he's got his eyebrows down and he's being very shouty. But the way that he does those, and the way that he acted in everything else that he was in, I mean, he was already renowned as one of the finest actors in Britain when he took on the role.
And I would even point out sort of that his choices do go a little further than those two extremes. Now, admittedly, in the two doctors, he does do a lot of contrived shoutiness, particularly with the sixth doctor and that sort of bickering with himself stuff that they're trying to play up. But you remember, like, you were kind of convincing me when we were talking about that episode about the choices he made when he was becoming an Androgum.
I was just going to say
that. The very relishing those lines of like brandy sauce and
brandy sauce,
really kind of going for something, you know, like that wasn't necessarily like doctory, but it was interesting and it was fun.
Good choices. You believed his transition into an Androgum because of that. Like you didn't believe it because of the orange eyebrows. He really sold it as an actor. So yes, he has had the opportunity to do that. And of course he did it in Enemy of the World. He played a different version of, you know, a doctor lookalike who happens to be a global dictator. And by all accounts, totally pulls it off. I guess we'll see when we actually watch that, fairly newly rediscovered story whenever we get around to it in the show. You think he's on the list? You think he makes the top
Troughton? I think you've convinced me that he's a better choice than Baker, even though I probably associate the sort of the template of doctorishness of going back and forth from those two modes with Baker more, but that's probably because I saw Baker before Troughton.
Right. And again, just totally pains me to say it, but like Tom Baker, you got to consider all of the other stuff that he's done. It's not a lot of other stuff, unfortunately. There was that moment where he did Hound of the Baskervilles on British TV, I believe. And everyone was sort of waiting to see his take on Holmes. And it was not, it kind of fell flat. Like, you know, he's had these opportunities to break out. He has just had great, great success as a voiceover artist. If this were a ranking of the best voice of any Doctor Who actor, he would be far and away the winner. I could listen to Tom Baker's voice all day. It's mellifluous and marvelous and just, yes, please. Tom Baker in my ear. Love it. But that's not what we're looking at. We're looking at acting chops.
So let's rebound back to the new series quickly. Yes. And I think we can, I think we're going to agree on this one,
what you're going to say.
Well, someone who shares my first name, I'll just say, and it's none other than one Peter Capaldi, as the 12th Doctor, who has been in this podcast, one of the favorite of our randomizer that bounces around everywhere. And it's kind of easy to see why in most of the episodes. He is fantastic. Like he definitely makes some choices that don't always work. And I think some of those were probably also influenced by Stephen Moffat. But generally, like I would say most of the time they do. And he also has, no one quite gives a doctor speech like Capaldi and gives it like enormous emotional weight, stuff that you can really believe. He's probably the best doctor, speechifier? Is that a word?
Best speechifier, absolutely.
Best orator, perhaps, as the doctor.
Yes, the best orator of all orators to play the doctor. Capaldi, I mean, it has to be Capaldi. We singled out his performance in Flatline as almost Emmy-worthy there. And the particular choice to play the Doctor low-key throughout so that he could give this massive oomph to the speech at the end of Flatline, which really does give you shivers. It's extraordinary. And you look at his movie career, and it's extraordinary. I mean, everything from Local Hero to David Copperfield to, like, he's one of the few doctor actors to, like, have had such a storied career before and after. Like, it is rare to get both sides of the coin. But he absolutely got it. And also, he's one of the few actors to play the Doctor who maybe the only actor to play the Doctor, who just sort of decided in his second season to play the Doctor almost entirely differently. Like, the difference between season one Capaldi and season two, you know, or eight and nine, is night and day, because he's decided not just to grow his hair longer. It's the biggest physical difference. He's a bit more loosey-goosey. You know, he's Dr. Disco. He's playing an electric guitar. But also, like, we've gone from mad, ranting Scottish doctor to he's less Scottish. He's decided to tone down his accent, and he sounds a bit more like Tom Baker in 9 and to a lesser extent 10. But certainly you listen to him in Heaven Sent, and you detect some real Baker tones. And he's saying, like, 5 billion years and all of that stuff. It really... Really, it seemed very noticeable to me that he'd made that decision to change who he was playing the Doctor. And he carries it off. Like, you still believe it. You believe both versions. You believe that he is in the Doctor in both versions. He's also... Well, it also... Capaldi may have also the most famous audition in the history of Doctor Who. Apparently, he just went to Stephen Moffat's house and, in the words of Moffat, was just doctoring about for a bit, like, didn't even have a script or anything. He just was doctoring about. And of course, he's one of these actors who has been a fan since his childhood. He's obviously been thinking about what his Doctor would look like his entire career, and he's got so much range, it's almost greedy.
You know, I almost think it's good that, not good that he only had one season with Bill, but that Bill and Pearl Mackey sort of get the fully realized, sort of gestated and perfected version of that Doctor, so that his Doctor, when Bill as the new companion can sort of bounce off him with, like, her questioning and sort of figuring out this world, that he's just ready for it, right? Like, they're just a great pairing, and that I think that's a big reason why season 10 really, really works, because Capaldi's at the top of his game, and then this great sort of young energy comes in and is infectious, and he sort of plays off that in his performance, and it's amazing. So yeah, Capaldi for sure, definitely on the top five.
All right, so I have a list of four. So I only
four
got
more
left. If we're doing a top five, Pete, are you going to include Troughton in your list, or are you hanging fire on Troughton for now?
You know, I'm going with consensus here. I'm not holding the fire for Tom Baker. I like Troughton. There's a lot of folks I like in there's a lot of folks I like on the whole list, but going for in sort of top five in terms of performances. The fifth one, are you thinking Are we going classic or new or remote?
I think we're going to have to fight over the last space in the lifeboat in this one. Because for me, I got to say, sorry to fans of David Tennant. Sorry to maybe Peter Davison might be another contender that I would think of. I think it's got to be Matt Smith.
Dude, we are so in sync. I was actually there too. Yeah. I was tempted to do Davison. He's my doctor. Honestly, we have our rating called Fixed Point in Time. He would be my Fixed Point in Time doctor. Like, yes. I still think Davison's great. We were just praising him in a recent podcast on Arc of Infinity about how he acts the hell out of every episode. I think that's absolutely true. Not at all. Like, he's a great actor to be in that role. He really gets the doctor. But Smith, yeah,
Davison,
man, like,
gets Davison gets honorable mention, I will say, for taking badly written scripts, because that is definitely a skill you need as an actor, the doctor, and giving them 110%.
Yeah, and again, I think we have to give so many honorable mentions, but we'll get to that in a second. Matt Smith is we haven't done the 11th hour for the podcast yet, but like, in terms of like getting that character and going from like 0 to 60 on convincing a skeptical viewership of like, should really this super young kid be in the role of the doctor? Does that make any sense? Yeah. And how is that going to go? I think it's going to be, it's Melrose Place as Doctor Who or something. And he comes in and just owns it from day one, like gets it, like, and is really convincing that this is a 1,000-year-old person in a young man's body. He just nailed the role immediately. And I think it's to his credit. I mean, I think not just to his credit, it's that what he's gone on to do since, right? Like, and it was a little up and down for a bit, but his range and the kinds of roles he's done, particularly you mentioned The Crown, which I thought he was really great in, honestly. Like, a lot of the time I was not thinking this is, where's the Sonic screwdriver or whatever. And then various movies he's been in, like, he's definitely got chops, really throws himself into the roles he's got. And, definitely my vote for filling out our top five.
Yeah. And I think it's interesting that we started the list with Hurt, who had, you know, old eyes that look young, and Smith manages the opposite feat of young eyes that look 1,000 years old. And he has such range when he's playing the doctor. He's Mr., you know, spinning top, doing the thing with his hands. But he's also like got that sadness, that deep bone rooted exhaustion and sadness in his eyes and in his manner, and he can slump like nobody's business. And that could so easily in a young actor look like, oh, you know, snap out of it, dude, you're just being emo, you know. But he sells it as you know, just the ennui of age, and it's no small feat to play the doctor in old age makeup like he does in Time of the Doctor and really carry it off. I think better than David Tennant did in Last of the Time Lords.
Well, and there's even other moments. Like, we did Closing Time for the podcast, and I think that's he does such a great performance in that one, because everything you just said really resonates about how he's going to that, he's going to go get killed at like Silencio, and the weight of that is sort of on him. He's having a bad time, and you just that those old eyes. And it just has you completely believe it in the state of mind he's in. It's just fabulous. And again, he can do all that whimsy that we were just talking about with Patrick Troughton, you know, in the same episode where he's goofing with the kids and has great lines and delivers those lines perfectly. Like, he's talking about, you know, go off and, you know, enjoy the toys, kids. Don't give your money to your parents because they'll just spend it on vegetables or something. like silly lines like that.
Yeah,
I mean, it totally works. Totally gets the role and delivers it every single week.
And he does. He can give Capaldi a run for his money in terms of speechifying, and often does very good.
Especially when talking to spaceships.
He does good talking to spaceships, but he also does a good understated speech. And I'm thinking of his very last one in Time of the Doctor. He does this thing of like, you've got to keep moving forward, like, you know, as he proposed.
We're all stories in the end.
No, well, that was the end of the first season, right? But this is, you know, time of the Doctor, where he's hit the reset button. He's about to regenerate before he sees Amy Pond, before he takes the bow tie off. You've got to keep moving forward. You've got to keep changing.
Yep.
And that's kind of lovely and understated. I think that's got to round out our list. So, wow, I did not expect such consensus between us.
Nor I, somehow. Even though we don't always agree on what ratings we should have in the show, we do have a similar sense of what Doctor Who is and what the role is. Although, again, honorable mentions, I mean, Tennant, it's hard not to have, we could do a whole podcast on him and, you know, why he's either overrated or underrated. But
we're going to get so many comments. We're going to get so many comments on this video for not choosing Tennant. He would obviously be the people's choice.
And honestly, Ncuti Gatwa, the jury's still out. I have not really seen a lot of his work. I saw a little bit of Sex Education, and he seems great. And I can see why he got the role. He may turn out to be just as amazing, and may, like, in the similar way that Matt Smith did, who got the role at a similar age, really impress so many.
Made a pretty good Ken in Barbie, which I just saw last weekend. But unfortunately, not a lot of lines.
Yeah, it didn't have a lot of chance to stand out, but he does do a lot of physical performance in that, which helps a bit. So he was a bit memorable. So we'll see. Joe Martin has been fabulous. Again, if I knew more of her work, I thought she did amazing work on the show. I've seen her around in a couple of other things, but nothing against her. And David Bradley, honestly, I like David Bradley.
Jodie as well, I think needs a shout out for her other work. You know, she's amazing in Broadchurch. She's amazing in Attack the Block. And I just don't think that Chibnall's writing, you know, direction of the show, unfortunately, didn't serve her very well. David Bradley. Yeah, well, mm-hmm. Good stuff there as well. He's Game of Thrones.
Yeah, I think David Bradley was pretty awesome. I think he doesn't feel as much like William Hartnell, but I do feel like he's sort of a revisionist version of that Doctor with a, you know, a little more depth here and there in certain things. And it's like, oh, okay. It had the show been a sort of a different thing at the time, this would have been like a perfect performance. So, yeah, I gotta say he at the times he's how many times has he done it now? Like, because he only did it in the one thing, and then he did Adventure in Space and Time, right? So,
yeah, he did Adventure in Space and Time. Then he did Power. No, sorry.
Oh, he was in Power of the Doctor too, right? Why? And Power of the Doctor. And Power of the Doctor. So, good. Good fallback as the First Doctor. I think he does great.
Yes, honorable mention for best replacement. For a doctor who's sadly no longer with us. Best upgrade in the First Doctor? I don't know.
It's compulsory.
Sorry, David. I was probably put Tennant sixth on this list. You know, certainly played the Doctor in the most incarnations, that's for sure. And look forward to finding out how differently he plays the 14th.
Yeah, it's going to be pretty awesome. I love Tennant. He did so much for the role in the show. He is definitely, in many people's minds, the Doctor, and plays that sort of dichotomy of playfulness versus seriousness in a different way, which I kind of like. Like, to his seriousness is like the whole oncoming storm. I'm this serious dude doing things. But that's a little fun. You know what I mean? It's like, it's hard for David Tennant to be on screen commanding the episode without it being fun on some level. And there's absolutely nothing wrong with that. And then that's not to say his range is limited or whatever. I think he's done so many other things, particularly in Broadchurch. When I watched Broadchurch, I was sort of taken aback by how different that role was and how sort of unlikable he was in very many ways.
You do have to knock him down a point, because he is the only Doctor who is denigrated on screen for putting an accent on.
Yeah,
Day of the Doctor, where he's derided as Dick Van Dyke, Basically putting on a Cockney accent, which of course is what what David Tennant does in this role. He has a great Cockney accent. He brings it to many other roles, but it is a little, it's a little too cartoon Cockney.
Could be, but I don't mind it. So I honestly did. It took me a while to realize he was actually Scottish because I hadn't seen any interviews with him until I think that his first season was done, and I was kind of surprised. That's our take on the top five actors to play the role Doctor Who. Guys, please comment either on social media on our choices. So that's, you can reach us at PultoOpen63 on most networks like Twitter, Instagram, Threads, and Facebook. Or go ahead and just comment on this video because you're watching on YouTube, right? And if you're not, go ahead. Please like and subscribe. Check us out at youtube.com/PultoOpen. Or TikTok at PultoOpen, all one word.
Like, subscribe, and or hate us. Smash that hate like button. Follow us out of spite so you can tell us how wrong we are and how dare we include Matt Smith and how dare we exclude David Tennant. And what were we thinking? And haven't we listened to all Paul McGann's big finishes? How could we exclude him? However we're wrong. If we got some Peter Cushing fans in the audience who want to tell us how much they love the fact that Governor Tarkin also and Van Helsing also played played the Doctor in the not very well regarded movies, whatever you've got to say, bring it on in the comments down below. Don't be shy, and we will see you soon for another random adventure and for more side quests into the Doctor Who universe.
Take care, guys.